Rob! Rob, I guess you can figure out what the hell I'm doing.
I know, right? I know. That was actually not my joke. That was not my joke. That was Samantha. Wait, is Samantha here?
Hi.
Not, no, not you. Is Samantha here? Yeah, okay. That, I stole that joke from Samantha, but not that Samantha. Okay, so this is going to be a little crazy because we're all nervous, so okay, yeah. I just did the last slide out of order. Okay, so I'm Bonnie. This is Samantha. I run NG Houston, which started out as a tiny little local meetup, and we actually went to YouTube about a year ago. So now we meet in person once a month, and then the other weeks we meet on YouTube. So if you guys don't have a meetup in your area, well, if you don't have a meetup in your area, start one, because I did and I was terrified, but it was actually really cool. It was a lot of fun. But if you don't have a meetup in don't have a meetup in your area, you can join our meetup because we live stream every Thursday night and we're a little goofy, but we actually have some really cool, like legit Angular stuff going on. So every Thursday night on YouTube, I have me and guests. Yeah, okay, so don't delete it. Okay, so who knows who your Uri Goldstein is? Okay, so today, just for the next 20 minutes, she's not Samantha, she's Uri Goldstein. Sometimes when core contributors talk, it's very confusing because they're speaking at such a high level, right? So it took me a while to wrap my head around what is GraphQL. And to be honest, when I first heard about GraphQL, I thought it was like a high charts D3 kind of a thing because it said graph, right? But it's not. It's not nothing like that. But anyway, so Uri was really helpful in the last month or two helping me prepare this talk. But he couldn't be here, so we have...
Oh, he is here.
That's so funny because he actually does that on Hangouts. He like goes like this. That's so cute. Okay, so... today we're going to talk about why we need GraphQL, what is GraphQL, and how is GraphQL used, right? So first, why should we use GraphQL? Who's seen, you guys have seen this before, right? You guys all.
Oh, yes.
Who has an old database with lookup fields? Yeah, yeah. SQL, Microsoft Access. Who's got the oldest database in the room? Yell it out. What is it?
A database.
What's that, like from 1987?
Software.
And you still have data in it that you're interacting with in your app?
Student information system.
Yeah, so see, okay, so we have a lot of, we have this new technology that's pretty exciting and we're really excited about it. I just said excited. Okay, so we have cool new stuff going out, but we have these old databases that can be kind of massive, right? And so how does that work? So that's what we're going to talk about. So even when, and we kind of moved forward, we went from SQL to REST API, which was cooler because it was less code, which was great, but we still have a lot of, we have to go and get these like ID fields, go back. If we want to do related stuff, like say we want to do like something like Netflix, right? And we get the movie, we get all the actors in that movie, and then we want to get all the other movies that that actor has been in. But we have to get the actor's ID first, and then make another request. You guys are familiar with this, right? So we have to keep going back and forth. And so that's kind of the issue that GraphQL is addressing. We don't want to do that. It's not about like graphs and charts like I thought it was. It's actually more similar to a SQL or a REST API. Are y'all with me? Makes sense?
Yeah.
So really it's those multiple round trips that we really want to avoid. So with GraphQL, it's a middleware, right? So basically you have this middleware, you have this layer that sits in between your database and your client, and it takes all those round trips, and then it serves it very simply, just like this, right? So when I saw this, I was like, okay, well that sounds really cool, but the problem is that I'm still making all those little round trips. So what is the point of doing that if I still have to make all those round trips back and forth to the database? I don't understand.
It is not going across the Wi-Fi. The payload is small because you're only getting what the client wants.
Thank you, Ori. That was awesome. Doing fine. Okay, so what Ori explained to me. What Uri explained to me was that the GraphQL server, right, I wrote a server, he had me going, because I had a bunch of stuff, I was stumbling through this whole GraphQL thing and I was kind of clumsy about it. And I was like, what's going on here, Uri? And he said, actually, what you need to do is take all that GraphQL stuff that I was learning, he said, put it on the server, because when you have the server, and keep in mind, I'm a front-end developer, I'm not a full-stack developer, I'm a front-end developer. So when he said, go write a server, I was like, no. Actually, what happened was, I got a tutorial and I'll tweet it out. I actually did tweet it out, but I'll tweet it out again for you guys if you want to see it. I went and I did this full stack tutorial and I wrote a GraphQL server. It took me like half a day. I've never done a server before. I made it, it was like 20, 30 lines of code. So then Samantha came home and I was like, I just wrote a server. Oh yeah. I was very excited, right? I'm like, I'm gonna update my resume right now, full stack, thank you very much. So I was pretty excited about that. This is not something that I really knew how to do, and it sounded really intimidating to me, but once I did, it wasn't that hard. It's a little tiny bit of code, right? So I made this server, and I was quite pleased with myself. But basically what he explained to me was, just like Uri said, when you have all these requests on the server is sitting like right with your database. It's not going across the Wi-Fi. So when you're doing all these back and forth to get everything you need, maybe you have a SQL server or a cloud service, B2B, whatever it is, even if your data is not, probably your data is all in one place, but the point is, whatever it is that you have, whatever data structure that you already have now, keep it, it's fine, just leave it right where it is, and then put this on top, and what this does is, number one, all those round trips are not going across the Wi-Fi, so what actually is going across the Wi-Fi is very efficient. You only get exactly what you need, and you don't get all the other stuff, you don't make a bunch of round trips, you get it all in one trip, and this GraphQL server, so maybe you have a whole bunch of SQL, you guys probably already have a bunch of SQL queries, right? You've already written that, it's already been there, it does that, right? So when you have all that in the server, what happens is it's not included in your bundle size. So what goes in your client, you guys are doing like ahead of time compilation and all, you wanna keep those bundle sizes small, so it hides all that complexity. Make sense? Y'all with me so far? All right, let's rock and roll. That's pretty good. So what is GraphQL? Does anybody know? Or do you guys are y'all already using it? Have you heard of GraphQL? How are you using GraphQL?
Yeah,
Are you like me, like I was? I was like, it sounds cool, but I have no idea what they're talking about. I was stuck in that state for a while. And that's why I'm trying to kind of break it down. Okay, so let's look at the actual, don't look at that yet. We're not there yet. Nope, not there. What happened?
I think you have to mute it.
What do I have to do?
I don't know.
Don't judge me. I have this.
Oh, yeah.
Oh yeah, they call him NG Jesus. That's why she's talking like that, because he has the long hair and they call him NG Jesus. Okay, this is the GraphQL.org page, right? So I wanted to show you guys this real quick because it kind of has the structure, right, of how this works. This is actually, once I wrapped my head around it and understood what it was for, and it's not for like, you know, charts and stuff, but it's basically like SQL queries or REST API. It's that API to allow you to get your data, right? Once I understood that, the actual code is really not that complicated. So we're gonna just scroll down here a little bit. It's a query language for your API. GraphQL is a query language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling those queries with your existing data. And at first I was like, I don't know what that means, but that's okay. So what I wanted to point out here is GraphQL.org is actually, oh, this is the one I want to show you. I didn't scroll far enough. Okay, so basically, this is what the query looks like, right? And if you imagine, this will replace a REST API in your client. That makes sense? So you're gonna go and you're gonna just get exactly what you need, and literally when you're writing it, this is what it looks like. It looks just like a JSON, who knows JSON objects? Y'all use these all the time. This is super easy, right? You can write a JSON object, you can write a GraphQL query. That's basically what it is. Okay, so let's get back.
How do I do the play from current slide to
this? I got this.
You're awesome.
Okay. So, whoa, what? Okay, so this is what it looks like. Actually, what I want to do, okay, so I made a GraphQL server, right, all by myself, and it was awesome. And she came downstairs at like 3 o'clock in the morning when I was working on it. She was making fun of me on Twitter. Okay, so I want to actually show you guys this little thing.
Don't
rock me. What did you do?
I went home.
Why would you do that? Okay. Okay, so the cool thing that I like about this, I made this, and I don't really have time to go into this too much, but let me just assure you that this is a public GitHub. I forgot the word GitHub. It's a public GitHub repo, and I'm going to share this with you guys. It's super simple, and you guys can look at this code later, or you can catch me in the hall, because I'm trying to get through all this. I don't know how much time I have left. Am I dead? Okay, we got to go. Okay, so I have this. What I like about this, and I want to show you this little feature, it's called Graphical. It's spelled GraphQL, which is kind of weird. This, I didn't build this, right? This comes with GraphQL. So this is like, well, actually, you know what? I'm going to show you real quick. I'm going to run out of time, and I'm going to get fired. This is so cool, you guys. So where is it? It's in the, look at my server. It's so cool. This is my server. Okay. This is the code, server.use graphical. So when I show you this functionality here, that's all the code that I wrote to make that happen, because this is something that's built. It's just a super clean interface. And the point of this is that when you're working on your, I know you guys have seen this before. Sometimes I'm trying, Thomas, where you been, man? He's already seen my presentation. I gotta go. Okay, so sometimes when I'm working, I'm like, I have a REST API, I'm trying to build my client interface, right? I need to know exactly how that data is structured. Sometimes I need to know the name of the field that I'm gonna put in my Angular, right? And I don't know, so this just makes it super easy. Honestly, at this point, I don't even need the channel ID, so I'm just gonna take that out, right? So it just gives me that. So this actually shows you, it's hooked up to my server, and here's the query, and it's gonna show you exactly the structure that you're gonna get back, and it's super convenient. Let me show you a little bit more here. So if I do this, I actually don't want all the channels, right? I have this little chat app for you in that thing. So if I put it like this, Critify. Say I only want the soccer channel, right? And there's the messages in the soccer channel. that make sense? Y'all with me? So I want to show you this interface because, like I said, it comes out of the box with GraphQL. It's very cool. And it's, oh, and here's the query variables. Let me move on. Where's my slides? Okay, the problem, once I got to this point and I was super excited, like, how do you get this? Now we have the graphical, right? And actually, and I literally did when I was first learning about GraphQL, I went to the graphical because they have one online that you can just go play with and just kind of figure it out and learn it. So I did that and I was like, this is really cool. I want to use this. Now I don't know how, like, what does the code actually look like, right? So the next step would be that there's an Apollo. It's called Apollo Client Library, and this is what actually Uri built, right? Apollo works directly with Angular. They actually have a React client. They have a couple of different clients, but the Apollo Angular client, you install this library, and once you install this library, let me show you. See, I spent too much time showing you all the code. And I'm going to run out of time, but I'm a developer, so I want to see the code. So let me show you real quick. This is what it looks like in my, is that too big? Shut that. That's what it looks like. This dot Apollo dot watch query, right? Oh, but the channel detail query. I'm going to click on that. This is what the channel detail query looks like. And remember, we just showed you this in graphical. It's literally exactly the same. So once you get it exactly the way you want it in graphical, you just copy and paste that. And literally, that's the code. That's not confusing, right? That's, that makes sense. It's pretty easy. Okay, so let's move on because I'm going to run out of time. Why don't you get me started talking up? I just never should. Okay, let's see a quick chat demo. Okay, so we showed it. We didn't. Did I see that? So here's my little chat. We didn't have time for any of the material because I'm sorry, there was a Harry Potter party last night, you guys. So we were going to put some CSS in here we didn't get to. Okay, so let's say hello, Uri. Ta-da! And it works. So, moving on. Okay, so, back to the slides. There's a problem. There's one problem with this. Who's heard of RxJS? Who kind of loves RxJS, right? This is pretty cool. So I learned, oh, you guys can see my notes. That's not cool. Legit excited about RxJS, right? And the problem is I learned pretty quickly how to get an observable. Like I can make an observable from a button. I can even make an observable from a text input field and I can like debounce it and I can like, you know, watch. So all of this stuff coming from the client UI, it's very easy for me to make an observable. Super easy. I did that. Well, it wasn't super easy, but you know, I figured that out pretty quickly. And I figured out pretty quickly how to get real-time updates out of the Angular Fire, right? Who's used Angular Fire? Anybody? So when you have these, y'all have heard of Firebase, right? You've heard of like, so when you have these cloud service databases, they're very modern, and you can push. So that's the, like as soon as I heard about observables, that's kind of the whole point, I think, is I want real-time updates, and that's almost becoming like standard features. Everybody wants to have that functionality. Once something updates in the database, I want it instantly because I'm not a patient person. So how do I do that? How do I get that out of my database? That was the problem. I know how to get it out of Firebase because Firebase has that functionality and Firebase has made it very, very, very easy to do. They have great documentation. So if you want to use Firebase, then this is going to be easy for you. However, you have to pay like every month. Maybe not in development, but like if you have a large production, if you have a lot of data, who's got a lot of data? Anybody have a large, I know you have tons of data, right? So if you have a lot of data and if you have a lot of traffic, that's gonna be something that you're gonna pay for. And if you have a large database that you've had for a long time, it's not that easy to migrate, and it's especially not that easy to convince your clients or your project managers to go from something free to something that they have to pay every month for, am I right? I probably wouldn't want to do that. So that was, I was kind of stuck because I was like, okay, I have this GraphQL thing and I like it a lot, but I'm still stuck with this dumb old database that can't send out an observable and I don't really want to subscribe. So how do I solve that?
You may keep your database. You need to follow subscription.
That's awesome. Okay, so I was talking to and Uri was explaining to me, because I was explaining to Uri that I was actually in the process of trying to convince my client to migrate the data up to the cloud so that I could have those real-time updates. And Oregon's like, no, you don't need to do that. You can keep your old dusty database and you can have that awesome new functionality that you want with your old database. And I was like, but how do I write that? I'm not a backend developer. Well, I am now, actually, because I work. How do I keep that, right? How do I get that? How do I get that old database to send me updates? That was like the big mystery that I've been wondering for ever since I first got out of RxJS. And I thought I couldn't do it. I thought I had to migrate the data to something more modern. But I don't, because I can use Apollo subscriptions. So, okay. Okay, so I see, I get out of, so what I'm saying is not in line with the slides. So what I'm trying to do, y'all forgive me. So I have this chat over here, right? And then I have this chat over here. Now, if I refresh the page and it fires that watch query, then it gets, because remember I just typed hello Oregon while I was up here, right? So it's great, but it's getting that on the page refresh.
We'll see that.
Thank you, Thomas. Because I'm still in the, I gotta end the show. Okay, it's a good thing you were here. Okay, so I typed hello Ori, right? And when I switched over, they y'all didn't see that. Once the page refreshes, it will pull that watch query, and every time I refresh the page, I'm gonna get the absolute latest data. So if I go, move this over. If I say hello Thomas, it doesn't see it, right? But if I refresh this page, it's there. It works. But I don't want to refresh the page. I want it now. So how do I do that, right? So that's exactly what I was talking about. I want it to push, because that's the whole point of an observable. Why would I have an observable if I have to refresh the page? That's ridiculous. Or read.
It's open source.
No, you're supposed to say use a subscription.
Use the Apollo open source.
Okay, so I'm going to show you this real, how much time do I have left? Am I good? I'm out of time. I'm going to show you this real quick before they drag me off stage. We didn't like to get the hook in there. Never mind, that was an old movie that you wanted to. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, we don't have a ton of time. Can you guys see it? Yeah. So I'm going to uncomment this. And remember, I can't really go through this code right now because I don't have enough time. But this is a repo. I'm just going to leave it here and let y'all look at this for a second. It's not that much code, right? And there's a little bit more code on the server that I don't have time to show you, but if you want to catch me in the hall or look at this GitHub repo later, we can talk about this more. But basically, this is the subscription, and now if I save this, oh wait, I gotta do one more thing, because now this data messages push is not gonna be on the client, it's gonna come straight from the server. So now when I add, I have that, the add message component is the little text input with the button that you just saw, right? So now it's going to come from the server. I'm going to update this. Oh, I don't even have to refresh it because it's going to. I'm going to refresh it. Wait. Okay. Now, hello, RxJS. Is it going to work?
Yes.
Look at that. I'm so glad this works. We're almost done. We're almost done.
Oh, no.
No, you can leave the wig off. It's okay. We're done with the wig. Okay. So I want to thank Justin. Where's Justin? Justin. You guys, everybody give Justin a hand. So I was trying to get this working. Now I will say the Apollo subscription is kind of new functionality, right? Because y'all have not heard of this before, right? But it's cool, right? So the thing with new functionality is sometimes it's a little bit buggy. It's open source. The docs are not that great.
I'm working on it.
Yeah. Lori's working on it.
Submit a pull request.
Okay, so the thing is that when I was trying to do that subscription, because I really want, I mean, it's, I don't really want to tell you guys about it unless I have a working demo, because it's not cool unless we have a working demo. So I was kind of freaking out. Thomas and Sander actually spent a bunch of time trying to help me figure this out. It was actually one line of code that the syntax wasn't exactly right, and we agonized over this because the docs are not really up to speed, and Justin is a genius and helped me just like yesterday morning, so it's kind of sweating. And if you guys want Justin to help you fix your code, he actually is available for hire. Just go talk to Narwhal because he can come and fix your code too, because he's amazing, and that's kind of what he does. Okay, so one more thing. Remember NG Houston, if you don't have a meetup in your area, join us on NG Houston because We meet online every week, and we're kind of goofy, but we actually do some really cool stuff, and we would love to have you guys join us. That's it. The GitHub repo, let me see. Oh, I got to end the show first. Let me show you the GitHub repo. It's here. There's the GitHub repo. bcarson/apolloangulardemo. That's it. Sorry, I think I'm out of. There is no time. You can use the wig.
I put it in the water,
though. Oh, dude. Okay. Yeah, let's go in the hall so they can set up. Did everybody get the GitHub repo that wanted it? Rob, will you tweet that GitHub repo? You guys have to follow Rob because he's going to get the tweet. I'll tweet it too. We'll tweet it and I'll tweet it for you. Thanks, guys.
Time to leave.